Why don't we begin by exploring one or two of your most unconventional perspectives that are underpinned by rigorous empirical validation? And we can discuss why these remain non-mainstream, despite, at least on the surface, having some robust scientific support. And also, we will get into the evidence for them as well.
Morphic resonance, which is the idea of memory in nature, inherent in all nature, and every species having a collective memory, and our own memories not being inside our brains. That's one. The extended mind is another, that our minds extend far beyond our brains, extend out into the world around us, and do so right now in every act of vision. Whenever we see something, I think the images are where they seem to be, outside our heads. And I test that by investigating the phenomenon of the sense of being stared at, when people can tell when they're being looked at from behind and turn around and someone is looking at them, which is scientifically known as scopesthesia. And I suppose the third area is telepathy, which is the influence of people's feelings, emotions, or needs on other people at a distance. And this also works with animals. So people's dogs and cats often pick up their intentions, as well as other people they're close to. So those are the three main areas in which I research, which are all of them sort of rather beyond the normal boundaries of science, of a sort of textbook academic science.
When you say that the mind is extended, in cognitive science, they have an extended cognition. Are you making a distinction between cognition and mind? And if so, what is that?
Well, extended cognition, are you thinking of the work of someone like Evan Thompson or David Chalmers? Or they have the idea of a kind of extended mind. A smartphone is part of our extension of our mind, or a blind man with a stick feeling his way, that's a kind of extension of the mind. Is that the kind of thing you mean?
Right. There's four E's of cognitive science. There's the embodied, inactive. There's extended and embedded. So embodied is quite obvious. We're not just our brains. We're also in our bodies, or cognition at least. There's also inactive cognition, which is the role of active interaction with the environment to aid your learning. So for instance, you ride a bike, it's an inactive process. There's balance, there's movement, there's feedback loops, and those are integrated in. And then there's extended, which is what you referred to. And then there is embedded, that we're embedded in an environment and our cognition is also there.
Yes. Well, there are various people who think that our minds extend beyond our brains, that we're embedded or inactive. Sort of Ava Noe, for example, has a theory that our minds extend beyond our brain, interacting as we interact with the environment. Andy Clark, who is another philosopher who has an idea like that. Evan Thompson, Max Velmans, all these philosophers of mind have the idea that our minds are not simply inside our heads. But when pressed, and when asked, you know, in what way does this make a difference, then they become rather evasive. You know, is it just that we project out a kind of a controlled hallucination into the world around us, which is totally non-physical, doesn't do anything and doesn't interact with the world or with anything else? Or is this extended mind something that actually makes a difference? Is our mind extending into the world in a way that can affect the world outside us? And I'm making a rather stronger claim than they are. I think that I've not seen any of them propose any experimental tests for their philosophy. It's kind of academic thing about the way you think about perception or cognition. I'm talking about something that's not just the way we think about it, but something that actually makes a difference in the world and which can be tested scientifically. So I think that my ideas are like theirs, are about the idea of the mind being extended beyond the brain. But I think of these extensions as being like fields, like the gravitational field of the Earth extends beyond the Earth. The magnetic field of a bar magnet extends around the magnet. The electromagnetic field of a cell phone extends around the phone invisibly. All of these are field phenomena which extend around material objects. And I think our minds are field-like and extend far beyond our brains and can have effects beyond our brains. Now, of course, I'm not talking about trivial ways that if I say something and someone hears it and they respond, that's having an effect beyond my brain. There's no disagreement about that.
Uh-huh.
I mean, that's totally obvious and is hardly even worth saying, you know. But what I'm talking about is something that's much more controversial. And so what I'm saying is that when we look at something, like when I look at your image on the screen right now, the images I'm seeing are projected out through my eyes to where you are. And the image of you is where it seems to be. It's in my mind, but not inside my brain. It's outside me, about 2 feet in front of me. And if I look out of my window at a tree, then my image of the tree is where it seems to be, outside there, about 50 feet away. So my image is being projected out. Now, this is not a new theory. This is a very old theory. Euclid, the great Greek geometer in 300 BC, had this idea that we project out visual rays. Our images are projected out from our eyes. And this is often called extramission, the sending out, extra out and mission sending. And what Euclid used his theory to explain was images in mirrors. So when you look at something in a mirror, what you see is a virtual image behind the mirror. And how does it get there? It gets there because you've projected it there. It's not really behind the mirror in a physical sense, but it's there because you've projected it. Every time we look in a mirror, I think we're seeing our own visual projections. And so I think that this kind of two-way theory of vision, light comes in, changes happen in the retinas and in the optic nerve and in the cerebral cortex and the visual cortex in particular, and then an outward projection of images in the opposite direction to the incoming light. Is what I'm suggesting. And what I'm, as I say, there's nothing original in this. It's what practically everyone in the world believes, except for scientifically educated people in Europe and America and anywhere else in the world in the last 100 or 200 years. It's a very, children spontaneously believe in visual extramission. That's why in Roald Dahl's book, Matilda, Matilda has eye beams that come out of her eyes that can move things. I mean, children love that because that's the way they think vision works.
Mm.
And Jean Piaget, the developmental psychologist, said that until the age of 10 or 11, most European children that he studied believe that vision involves an outward movement of images. But after they're 10 or 11, they learn at school what he called the correct view, which is that thoughts and images are invisible things located inside the head. So what I'm saying is not only does vision work like that, but when we look at something, we can actually affect it by looking at it. That's where I differ from some of the inactive or other extended mind theorists. And the way to test it is to say, well, what if you look at another person from behind or an animal from behind? If they can feel your looks, then they might turn round. And they do indeed turn round. It's a very, very well-known phenomenon. About 95% of people have had the experience of looking at a person or an animal who then turns around and looks straight back at them. And most people have had the converse experience of not necessarily consciously knowing why, but they just turn around and there's somebody staring at them. So that's the phenomenon of scopesthesia. And the reason I think it's interesting is because it can illuminate the nature of vision. And it's astonishing that in the 21st century, we still don't know how vision works.
So an analogy for people who know the X-Men. I don't know if you're familiar with the X-Men.
I'm not actually, no.
there's a mutant named Cyclops, and what he does is when he takes off his glasses, there's a powerful beam of light enough to destroy buildings and so on that shoot out of his eyes.
Oh, I see.
So that's akin to what you're saying, except that it's much less powerful.
That's akin to what I'm saying, and the reason that they'd have that, and it would seem plausible to readers of X-Men comics or whatever they are, is because that's what a lot of people implicitly believe. And Superman comics used to have the same thing.
Right, right, yes. Exactly. He has the same...
Yes.
I think X-Men just took it from Superman. Yeah. I should have said Superman.
So that's right. So that's what I'm saying, that something like that is actually happening. And of course, from the point of view of conventional science, that's a tremendously heretical thought, and it's considered a childish illusion or misunderstanding.
Here would be one reason, one physics-related reason. Let's say you're looking at something, then you should feel extra pressure backward, and that object should feel extra pressure forward, and that's something measurable. And then you can also measure that when someone's looking at something and when someone's not looking at something.
Well, funnily enough, there was a study carried out in Princeton three or four years ago, and then at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm by a psychologist called Arvid Guttestam. And Guttestam and his colleagues did a very, very interesting experiment, extremely clever and ingenious. They showed people a picture on a computer screen of a person looking at an upright cylinder, a cardboard cylinder. And all the person did was saw on the screen this cylinder. And then the cylinder tilted towards them. And they had to press a button when they thought the cylinder would fall over. And they did this experiment with people in the university who all denied the possibility of extramission, who were convinced it didn't really happen because they'd been educated to believe it didn't happen. And they did the experiment where they showed them this person looking at it. Then they did the experiment where they had the person with a blindfold over their eyes, a cartoon-like drawing, a blindfold over their eyes. And then they had the cylinder tilting. And the angle at which it fell over was different, significantly different in these two cases. The people didn't realize they were being tested for this. But what it implied was that when the people were looking at it, it tilted at a greater angle, as if it were being held up by a force. And they even calculated the magnitude of this force that that was implicitly coming out of the eyes, about 1/100 of a newton. Now, they're not saying this force really is coming out of the eyes, but what they're saying is that the way in which people responded to this test was as if they implicitly believed a force came out of the eyes. And they even did then brain scans and found that people's brains changed in such a way that they attributed a movement to the eye gaze. The movement bits in the brain were activated. It was a very sophisticated piece of research published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. And so what they showed is that it's hardwired in us to believe that a force comes out of the eyes. Even people who didn't believe it does, when tested in this way, not realizing what was going on, implicitly believed that there's a force coming out of the eyes. Their interpretation was that this has been built in and hardwired in by evolution because it's important for us to know which direction people's gazes are pointed, because the gaze is very important in social situations. And for animals as well, and that this had been hardwired by evolution into our brains, and it then created this illusion of a force going out of the eyes. But in evolutionary terms, I think it makes much more sense if it's not an illusion, if it's real. And so they didn't even consider this possibility, because they started by saying this, of course, is totally impossible, but this is an illusion that's hardwired into us. And that's why so many people believe in it, because it's an illusion. So what I'm saying is that maybe it's not an illusion. And it's not that they carefully considered the possibility that it might not be an illusion. The most recent paper on the sense of being stared at that they quoted was from 1910, and it was from a skeptic saying it's rubbish, and they ignored all subsequent research on the subject because either they didn't know about it or they thought that it was so obviously impossible, it's not even worth mentioning. So we've got here something that's very close to everyday experience for most people, and which is at the very frontier of science and scientific controversy, with huge implications for the nature of minds and the nature of vision.
If you enjoyed this toll clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. Don't forget to follow Theories of Everything with Curt Jaimungal on Spotify for exclusive content and in-depth discussions. Your support on Spotify helps us grow and to reach more curious minds like yours. Check out the link in the description and join the Core Toe community on Spotify today. See you there.